I would love for Rock to get like that, man. Are you serious? Like, yeah. If we just put stuff out as we finish it, man.
Yes, my friends, this is, of course, the world-famous Kerrang Radio, and joining me on the show today is Jeremy McKinnon from A Day to Remember. How are you, sir?
I'm doing good. Can't complain. Just out here in Florida, living life.
Let's start talking about some music, because it's been a very busy month for A Day to Remember. But before we get into your welcome, I actually want to talk to you about the song that you gave us before that album cycle, the collaboration with Marshmello. Like, as a big EDM fan myself, I would love to know how that all came about, where the conversations came from.
Mello had hit us up, honestly, like years prior to that, that he wanted to collaborate with us, but and we were interested from the get-go, but there was never any material passed back and forth. It never really went further than just, hey, we should do something. And he actually hit us back again and sent us an idea, and management sent it over to me. And I'm a person that either I hear what I'm gonna do almost immediately when I hear an idea, or I don't. And if I don't, then, you know, I'm gonna have to put time and effort into it. And just in my experience, a lot of times the songs that I really have to roll over a bunch don't tend to be the ones that connect as well. It's the ones that are just like immediate. Yeah. The ones that are immediately there, like genuinely lightning in a bottle inspired, are usually the ones that people tend to like for whatever reason. And so I was nervous to open this song up, you know, like he sent me this file. I'm like, oh my God. So I'm like prepping doomsday on the other side. Like, okay, what am I going to say when I don't know what I'm going to write over this? Like, cause I don't want him to be upset. You know what I mean? Like, and I opened it up, and immediately the track just like fell out of the sky. And yeah. And I had like the majority of it within 30 minutes, went the next day and tracked it and finished up anything that I didn't have with my dude, Andrew Wade, who we do a ton of stuff with, and sent it to him. That next night, we didn't even get a response from him. And then I'm getting all these like texts in the group message, like, yo, so it would have been cool to know we were doing a Marshmello song. And I'm like, oh, sorry. I mean, I'm just waiting on him to respond back to me. And, but I think you're going to like it when you hear it. Neil was like, I have heard it and I like it. I just wish that I knew about it. And I was like, what do you mean? What do you mean you know about it? And he's like, Marshmello just posted the chorus of the song online that night.
What?
And I was just like, as a rock musician who like, you know, plans out releases and like, we're never allowed to do something like that. You know what I mean? He put it out immediately. I didn't even know he liked it yet.
That's
and
incredible.
He had posted, like, it was hilarious, honestly. And man, how awesome of a setup rappers and EDM artists have like made for themselves. Like, you can just put it up.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Like,
no warning, no press, no cycle, no nothing. It's like, we got it, let's drop it.
I would love for Rock to get like that, man. Are you serious? Like,
yeah.
If we just put stuff out as we finish it, man.
Hell yeah. Like, as someone in radio, if we wake up one morning and it's just like, oh yeah, by the way, A Day to Remember have just dropped a song out of nowhere with, you know, a massive rapper. Like, I know, let's throw someone like Joyner Lucas out there who's collaborated with your boys in I Prevail. Like, that would blow our minds, our collective minds.
I know rock fans also still love the album format too. And especially a band like ours, like, who put a lot of time and effort into making those albums, you know, have a storyline, have deeper meanings if you're looking for the deeper meanings.
Yeah.
I know that that's a special thing. And, you know, especially in this world, that's happening less and less for you to have options for that, you know? So I do get the other side of it. But it would be fun to just put out stuff randomly.
Yeah. Hell yeah. Well, maybe in the future, you could start pioneering that kind of movement of just catching us all by surprise.
I mean, I think a few people have been doing it, and it's working out really well for them. Like, the dudes in Falling in Reverse have been doing that, and some of their biggest songs of their career have just been these random singles they're dropping. So I know that they do it. I know that there's a few others too. I mean, Bring Me put out that EP with theirs. So I guess they're still kind of releasing stuff around the things they put out. But
yeah, that EP there are people. I know, didn't it?
It did. So it that's kind of similar, but an EP is still an EP. But there are other rock artists I just can't think of off the top of my head that have been doing that format. It's working really well for them. So I guess it's just up to the fans. Like, what do you guys want? Do you want random songs strewn out throughout the years, or do you want whole albums?
And do you think that the sound of heavy music from both the dance world and the rock world is now starting to move in this collaborative direction?
I do think so. And that'll happen more and more, I feel like, especially now that hip hop is starting to kind of mesh with pop punk and rock a lot more than it has in the past. And that's been slowly happening through the last 3 years or so. You know, you've been hearing like hip hop songs, and the main part of the beat is like this clean guitar with some reverb on it, you know. Yep. What I mean, doing like something that you could hear in like a Blink song or something.
Yep.
So that's the first time I started hearing songs like that. I was like, hey, if this starts to be a thing, have we got some stuff for you guys?
So
I just mean like if rap artists really do get into this style of music more, which it seems like they are, like there are so many people that write these kind of songs that could help, you know. And like, I'm first and foremost, I see myself as a writer. Like I really enjoy the creation process of music. That's really why I do it. So yeah, that's really what I mean. Like, I don't have like rap songs set aside, but I'm just saying, like, to collaborate with people, like, I would love to write with people making hip hop songs. That would be so much fun for me. I'm excited about it all. I think it's nothing but good for everybody involved. Like, to have rock guitars potentially be on the radio, positive. That hasn't been happening in a long time.
Yep.
Seriously, the last time that rock was even really being played on the radio was when we put out What Separates Me From You, and we got All I Want on K-Rock in the States, you know. And like, since then, every album since then, there haven't really been guitars in the music that's been played. So it's all positive, man. Like, people can say what they want, but, you know, more attention towards things that inspire bands like us, all the bands that I've grown up with here. It's all positive to me, man. It's like, if one of us win, all of us win. Like, this world, that's it, dude. And I actually think that's something that holds rock back. It's like, there's so many of us, and it's like, especially bands like mine. It's like, we've all been doing this together for so long. Like, let's just band together, let's continue to push this genre as a group, because when I'm doing well, we'll help you guys. When you're doing well, you help us. Like, and what's going to happen from that? Everybody wins. It's just like, everybody wins. You can bring up little guys with you. You know what I mean? It would just be such a positive thing. And you see it happening all the time in hip hop. You see it happening in EDM. You're talking about collaborations right now. You don't see as much real collaborating in the rock world. People don't seem to be as interested in collaborating as much as I've always wanted to. I don't know. Like, I've always just been, I guess us being a genre fluid band.
Yeah.
I guess lends itself to do that easier.
What a phrase, by the way, genre fluid band.
I just started saying that lately. I don't know. You're right. Like, I've never heard that before anywhere, but it's true. I mean, that's what the band is. You know, we just like in and out of different genres, and, you know, we're adding more genres by the album.
Love it. Well, speaking of being genre fluid and adding more genres in, let's get into your welcome, because listening to this album, I feel like A Day to Remember gambled just a little bit more than they have done on previous records. You went, okay, let's sonically push ourselves into areas that people might not expect us to put our fingers into. And was that something that consciously you had in mind before recording the record, or was that something that came out whilst the record was being written and recorded?
So just like with any Day to Remember record, there is no target.
Cool.
Every album we've ever made is very much like what we're inspired to do right now in the moment, what we feel is right. And then we write and we work on whatever comes natural, and we choose the best that we have from that batch of songs.
Killer.
And this record was, you know, we did do a lot of collaborating. We wrote together. We wrote with buddies in other rock bands. We wrote with other people that inspire us in different genres. Like, it was all
awesome. Those people, if you don't mind me asking.
Well, you know, some of those songs aren't finished.
Ooh, okay. You know,
I mean, we did a song that isn't done, but I hope to finish it soon because it's got a monster chorus on it with Alex from Whitechapel.
Damn.
Yeah, dude, it's sick. It's sick. I definitely need to work on it more.
Okay.
It's not done. That's why it didn't make it. I'm always like, I would never want to just, okay, well, I think the chorus is right and the pre-chorus is right. The rest of it doesn't matter. Throw whatever all over the top of it and then put it out and see what happens. I'm very much like, let's save it. Let's keep working it until all of those parts feel that good. That way it has the best opportunity that it can have to be. Yeah, man. And that mindset gave us songs like Lauderdale. Lauderdale was a song like that we held back. That was actually written for Homesick. But the chorus was terrible. Chad ruined the chorus for me. He like made up some like joke lyrics about I got big balls and I could never get. It was the catchiest chorus. He's like, I got big balls. I got big balls. I got big balls. Let me hand them to you. And I could never sing that over the top of that music, and you will understand. I could not get that out of my head for Homesick, and I couldn't rewrite it. I couldn't write a chorus that was better than that, and I couldn't replace the words.
That's so good.
But it worked out because if I had written a chorus over the top of it, there's no way it would have been as good as the one that landed on it. You know what I mean? Which is incredible. I hate this town, and now that's like one of the main songs we're known for now. You know,
yeah.
So I always protect these songs. We also wrote a little bit with our dude, Vic from Pierce the Veil.
Awesome.
Another awesome idea that just, we had so many songs, there was no way to focus on everything at once. I hope to get that to the finish line one day. And when I say this, like, I really mean this, like collaborating the way I was talking about earlier, not just like these people sing the bridge that you wrote. That is the only thing that rock artists do. I feel like that's like the stereotypical thing. Like, this person's working on it. You just throw them on the bridge. You know, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or like best case scenario, they sing the chorus. This is me in a room writing a song with these guys.
Sick.
You know what I mean? Like, what does it sound like for a Day to Remember and this to write a song together? Like, they think this is cool. I think this is cool. I would do this. They would do this. What does that sound like? What is Whitechapel and a Day to Remember writing a song together sound like? You know, like, I'm interested in that. That's what I am
as well. Like, you have my full interest, sir.
Yeah. Everybody's going to be mad at me that I told you that, but you asked the right question at the right time, I guess. Whoops. It's not done. I don't want anybody getting their hopes up. I tell people stuff way too soon, and then people just, things get too long in advance. We'll see. I got a lot of work to do on that song, so don't get too hyped. It's nowhere near done. And there is no end in sight for that one. So, you know, for all I know, we put that out in 8 years from now. But hopefully we get it done soon. don't, I'm not even saying erase soon. Just hopefully it gets put out. But the point is, like, we were trying to collaborate with anyone and everyone we could. And this record is where we ended up, what we thought was the best out of what we did.
Obviously, there was a little bit of a delay with the release of the album. I can imagine through this campaign, you've been asked a million times why that was. But to cut a long story short, just to give people who might not know, what's the condensed version of why it took a little bit longer to drop than initially planned?
So I missed our deadline when it came to finishing the record. We left LA and it wasn't quite done. There was like two bridges and two songs that I didn't feel was right. This was like when the record was supposed to be finished. We then had Colin, our producer, come out on the Degenerates tour in the States. We finished those parts. I don't remember what the dates of that was, but that's when the record was actually done being recorded. And then everything since then has been mixing, mastering, album artwork. And in the midst of all that, COVID happened, and then everything got divvied to email, and that really slowed us down to a snail's pace. And, you know, here we are this many years later, and the record is finally out. So COVID happened more than anything.
Has there been something that the band have tried to do in order to try and get this album out in different ways without the presence of live shows?
So we're actually working on that right now. We're going to do like a big show that we stream, some big event with a lot of production. We're going to put a lot of time into doing something special for everybody to present these songs the way we want to present them live. And then play a bunch of the bangers too. So we're gonna make it like a legit show with amazing production that hopefully we can take at least a bit of it on the road. This is gonna be like way more than we could ever afford to do at a normal show every night. So it's gonna be cool. I'm excited. I've already seen some of the initial idea, and man, possibilities that we could do with this setup is pretty awesome. So I'm excited.
Gangster. So that's something to look forward to and a day to remember live stream in the future. Jeremy, thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to come and chat to us. And I think I speak for everyone who's listened to Your Welcome when I say this is one of the best albums that you've ever released for us. And can't wait to see these songs on a live stream someday.
I can't wait till we do it.
Hell yeah. And let us know about that Whitechapel collaboration, yeah?
Yeah, when it's done, whenever we finish it, who knows when that's going to be. But yes, we will.
Killer. Thank you so much, my friend, and enjoy the rest of your day.
You too. Thanks for having us.